All right, it's a Wednesday morning on the Audible. Kim Bokamper here with you. If you're watching, you're watching us on Periscope. If you want to send questions in, just go to the bottom of your page there on the message bar. Go ahead and what did I say? Wednesday morning? Well, you know, for me, it is morning. I got up late today, so it's it feels like morning to me. It is afternoon. My man Leon. Leon never misses a beat, never misses a chance. He never misses a chance to beat me down there.
He was doing that early. He only fits my collar.
Yeah, well, that's all right. But okay, Wednesday afternoon here on the Audible. You can see us starting tomorrow on a delayed broadcast on the Miami Dolphins Facebook page. You can see us on MiamiDolphins.com pretty much whenever you want. It goes on after about an hour after this. You can also go on the Miami Dolphins YouTube channel, and you can see any of the archives you want. Joining me now, Kaleb Thornhill is with me now. And Kaleb, you do player development. But what's the exact title? Director of Player
Engagement.
Engagement. Yeah. There you go.
It was programs, then development, then engagement.
But the bottom line is your part of your responsibility, a big part of your responsibility, is helping players become the best people they can be, and helping guys prepare themselves for life after football.
Yeah, I think it's the whole life cycle, though, yes. Kim. You know, in terms of guys transitioning in.
Coming in.
Right? Yep. Maximizing and understanding that transition, how many things go along with that. So really our philosophy with Eve Batoba and myself is to engage, educate, and empower individuals to reach their full potential, both on and off the field. So we're here to help prolong careers, but also leverage and maximize them while they have the platform.
So we're in free agency now. The draft is coming up. And certainly after the draft, then you kind of kick into gear then, because that's the first group of guys that you need to kind of initiate them into the NFL, initiate them into life in the NFL, initiating them into the culture here with the Dolphins that's been created, and how you need to – how do you start that process, and how does that work for you?
That process really began a month ago. Mm-hmm. You know, in terms of February is our month, March is our month, to really develop that platform of what type of activities are we going to do for these guys? What type of programs? What type of information do they need? Because really, information is one thing. We want them to turn that information into knowledge that they can use right away. So even I, my counterpart, we met for 3 hours yesterday just going over the rookie program in terms of the rookie experience. And we want to know, all right, do we have everything in place from a resource, from a knowledge? You know, money changes, relationships change, knowledge of the game, what it takes to be a pro. How do you balance everything, right? And so for us, it's basically going, all right, this is the platform we're going to give them. But above and beyond these sessions, we're all about establishing a relationship so they can understand how to maximize their time in the NFL. And that takes time. It takes repetitions. Yeah. It takes a lot of work outside the building.
How long have you been here, Kaleb?
Been here 8 years.
Okay. So you're aware of, you've seen this, and I would say they started this this type of a program, I would guess back in 1990 maybe, somewhere in that ballpark, somewhere right around 92. There. And quite frankly, it's been a very slow-moving ship.
Yeah.
Like trying to turn an aircraft carrier around, right? Because, I know some of the issues that – the guys in your position, and each team, I don't know if each team still has a guy. Each team has a guy in that position. Yep. And look, some teams, that guy, I don't want to hear from you. You do what you need to do, and I don't want to hear from you. I've watched this team and the different guys they've had and the position itself change to where it is right now, which to me, I believe is a pretty good blueprint for most teams, because it's meaningful. It's good information. It's not just holding the guy's hand and making sure he gets to an appointment somewhere he needs to be. It's about real life skills, and no further than this last week when you guys were up in New York for the business combine with Mr. Ross, and you're up there with 16-17 guys. And from everyone I talked to, it was just a phenomenal experience. An experience that, as the people I've spoke to, including yourself, that all those guys that went there walked away, I don't know you could put a value on the information they gleaned from that week up in New York with the type of people that they were around.
People would pay a ton of money to go up there and have the access that these guys had and being able to meet with the individuals they were and the information that they gathered. I mean, these 16 guys took it so serious, and the feedback we've gotten so far since we came back was just phenomenal, transformational. Thanks for changing, you know, my trajectory in the NFL and really helping me leverage it. And what happens is now that these guys are talking about the experience that they had in New York City and the value that they got out of it, other guys in the locker room came up to me and was like, "Hey, Kaleb, I wasn't invited to that.
Yeah.
You were. You just weren't listening." Yes. So, you know, I think it's going to create a trend. And we have an owner in Steve Ross in an organization that is all about maximizing the potential on the field and maximizing it off the field. And I'm lucky to be a part of an organization that truly has that, because, like I said before, my whole goal is to create experiences for these guys that really can transform their life. And that experience and how we grow as human beings, 70% experiences, 20% self-reflection, and 10% new knowledge. So my job is to really give them new knowledge, allow them to self-reflect, to create new experiences and be part of experiences where they can truly grow as human beings, as men, as fathers, as husbands. That's what we want them to do. Because we always say, if the man's not right, the player will never be right.
Yeah.
We got to get the man right. So I think this is a step in the right direction of building great men for our organization and players.
You know, one thing, when you look at, you know, you look at the NFL, and fans look at the NFL, and people that are watching the show look at the NFL, and they talk about players and free agents and this guy and that guy.
Yeah.
You know, when you look at it, if a guy handles himself properly, you know, each and every player in the NFL is in essence a business within himself.
Yeah.
It just depends on what they want to do or how far their imaginations can go to where that business ends up when they're done playing.
I mean, Kim, you're a prime example of that, you know?
And
your experiences. So it's good to have individuals like yourself that can even build into our men. And you've been part of my rookie success program, part of veteran programming, and opening your doors of knowledge and information for our current guys. And even former guys. Yeah. So for us, we've cultivated a culture of wanting to help one another. And Nat Moore and the Alumni Association and what they're able to do. And so when you look at that, my job is to bridge the gap for these guys and really show them, if you leverage this game the right way while you're here with the support you have, to your point, those relationships that you have cultivated and developed can really turn into something substantial long term and help you find passion and purpose after the game is over. You know, people always talk about, you know, preparing them for life after football. That's preparing them for life right now and what life is all about, which is relationships.
Look, there's life after football, but you're not dead while you're playing.
Right.
You got a life while you're playing. You got your starting family.
For sure.
Kids are having, young guys are having children.
Yep.
They're developing their family, all those things. So, you know, there's life after practice too.
Yeah.
That you
got life after practice. Yeah. You just got nothing to get screamed at. Right. Now you go home to your wife, you don't want to talk for 30 minutes.
Yeah.
How do you handle that? Or how do you communicate? And, you know, that's why we do couple huddle retreat.
Yeah.
We bring them together to navigate Will's trust estate planning. Yeah. They have kids, right? You're going to have issues within your relationship. How do you handle them?
Yeah.
And giving them the tools to be successful in all phases of their life. This is about a holistic development approach that we've instituted from the very beginning. And we've seen tremendous results because of it. The emails I receive back from former players is phenomenal. Yeah. And I still send them opportunities that are available throughout the league, throughout the Miami Dolphins. And really, just the appreciation for still staying in touch, even though it takes me 10 seconds to send that email off, is phenomenal.
Yep.
So you get to really see the life cycle, Kim, as you mentioned, what we talked about in the beginning of helping them leverage and stay in the NFL. You know, obviously we want them all to be here, but some are going to graduate to free agency, what's coming up. And some of them are going to stay here. So as long as I have them, and even when they're gone, I can still somewhat stay in touch with these guys.
Good. Hey, you're watching the Audible here on a Wednesday afternoon, Leon. You're watching us on Periscope. You can send your questions in on the bottom page. You can also watch us on a rebroadcast beginning tomorrow on the Miami Dolphins Facebook page. You can see us all the time on MiamiDolphins.com. Let me just give you some news on the day. Andre Branch, Ian Rappaport of ESPN, is reporting that he's going to sign a three-year contract, $27 million. This is what he's reporting. It's not official from the team, so just keep that in mind. Tony Romo is expected to be released tomorrow. Brandon Marshall, who was released by the Jets yesterday, signed with or is expected to sign with the Giants tomorrow, 2 years, $12 million tomorrow is when they can start signing. 4 o'clock tomorrow is when the league season begins. They can start signing. The Dolphins have tendered four exclusive free rights, free agents, Thomas Duarte, the tight end, Mike Hall, the linebacker, cornerback Lafayette Pitts, and center guard Anthony Steen, all guys that that contributed last year to this football team. Thomas Duarte, a guy that they're looking to maybe take that next step and be a part. So just a little bit of the news that's going on now. Free agency, as I said, begins tomorrow at 4 o'clock. So we'll do that. What say we take a few questions here, Caleb?
Let's do it.
Joey Bag of Donuts. Caleb, what's your best – don't be surprised at some of the names that come up here. Joey Bag of Donuts.
Donuts. Well, I want to know what his favorite donut is.
Caleb, what's your best off-field success story for a former or current Dolphins player?
You know, I would say without mentioning a name, really was a guy that went through a lot of turmoil when he first transitioned into the organization. And this went from a kid that – didn't listen to anybody. And as we started to peel back the onion of his upbringing and just having those crucial conversations over time, is that I got to the root cause of what he was really bothered about. And he wasn't able to communicate well. And he ended up not only benefiting from that conversation and his communication with coaches and really becoming better because of it, is that he performed well on the field once he got better with the communication piece. And then after that, because of our relationship, he was able to maximize the Business Academy, which is different than the Dolphins Business Combine, and actually has a job now, has successfully transitioned out of football, has a tremendous family, and we still talk to this day about that conversation that led to a path of quite frankly, success, what I view as success after the game is no longer part of his life. But again, I think, you know, him having that conversation gave him a few more years in the NFL because it was spiraling downhill.
So you've got to be a friend, a mentor, a disciplinarian, a psychologist, a little bit of everything. You're as you go along with these guys, and you got what? There are 53 guys in the roster, but there's probably 80 guys in that locker room at any given moment because of injuries and this and that. Yeah. So you got 80, 90 guys that you're kind of juggling on a regular basis.
It's fun, though. Like, I mean, for me, it's just genuine, authentic relationships. Life is all about relationships. Mr. Ross, you know, Steve Ross mentioned it up in New York City when he spoke to all 16 guys and me in the room and Ibitoba, is that everybody we came in contact with always came down to relationships. Who do you do business with? Steve said, you know, he only associates with people that are genuine, authentic, that do the right thing. And so when you look at the approach that I've always had, is just being genuine, authentic, inviting them into my life and the trials and tribulations that I still go through, and being transparent with a guy. And once you open up that door, you help them understand, like, I'm in it for you. You know, I want to see you win. And when you can be genuine and authentic about that, you'll be surprised. Guys are willing to open up their doors and have any type of conversation with you. So to your point of everything you mentioned, maybe their money, you know, talking to them about money and going through, I always tell people any conversation from A to Z, I probably had in my office at some point.
Good stuff. Black man, at Black Man Game, do you guys help the rookies find housing? Guy comes to town and doesn't expect to make the team, or expects to make the team or whatever, and all of a sudden, you know, you that last cut down day, the guy goes, hey, I made the team. Where am I going to live?
So we pride ourselves, you know, as you talk about that relationship piece, it's the first touch point with either themselves or the family is, where am I going to live? Where are their short-term housing available month by month? You know, my goal is to keep money in their pockets and make sure, as I said about relationships, is associating them with the right individuals. Yeah. We have a whole onboarding website that goes through every resource. We call it Elite Resources and Services website, where they can go and log in there and see just about anything. And we can walk them through the process. But I just want to make sure, I could care less if a guy is using somebody. I want to make sure they're trustworthy. I want to make sure we've had a background check. So in terms of housing, absolutely. What areas are best? Where do my kids go to school? Right? Those are important decisions. Where? How close is it to my doctors? If the wife's pregnant, which we have right now, where's the pediatrician? So we always want to be that resource guide, not to enable them, right? As we talk about giving resources, to empower them, all right? To use that information to build that relationship. Now the relationship is yours. Go ahead and take it.
Scooby Fins Up. Do you guys believe Adam Gase has created a culture that outside players will want to become, will want to join and be a part of?
No question.
Yeah.
You know, I think when I think about culture,
I think anyone who's been around Adam believes in that completely too.
When I think of culture and what he's been able to create, and you watch, as we talked about, the relationship piece and watching him communicate with players and understanding how to motivate and get the most ever out of guys, he wants to see guys win mm-hmm. on the field. Like, he wants to put every individual in a position to win on the field when yeah. you're dealing with players and in our organization. He's always pushing people. He pushes me to become better, and he pushes everybody else the same way, and he cares about people. So I think when you create a culture like that where you know he wants you to maximize your potential, you get a win-win situation yeah. of a guy that you'll do anything for, and that's what we're creating.
And you create, you know, I think he's created an environment here of where, look, free eight players talk. They're such, everybody knows it, you know. I don't know, everybody doesn't know everybody, but right. you know somebody that knows this guy, right. someone knows yeah. that guy. And players talk, and when it comes to free agency, guys go, hey, what's it like down? You know, they're talking to me, I don't know what I'm doing, but what's it like down there? Right. Right. And I think with this short year that he's been here, mm-hmm. I think the word coming out of this building is, hey, man, this is a place you want to be.
Absolutely.
And that certainly, look, there's a lot of things that factor into free agency mm-hmm. and why a guy signs one place or another.
Absolutely.
But it certainly doesn't hurt to have an environment where guys are saying, hey, you know what? You come down here, you're going to like it.
Yeah, I think not only you're going to like it, right? You're going to be invested in multiple ways.
Yes.
We're going to exhaust every resource possible to help you reach your full potential
yeah.
from top down.
Yeah.
And that's on the field, that's off the field. And yeah. when a guy sees that and knows that we are a culture and an organization yeah. that has done that and continues to do that, guys undoubtedly are going to say, hey, this is a place I want
to
yeah. be.
Well, here's a good example to me. Talking about that, about the business combine you went up to, and Dominican Sue was up there, Ryan was up there, you know, the big guys were up there.
Yeah, Cam Wake.
Sam Young was up there. Sam Young was off the team for a while last year.
Yeah.
So it's not, you know, so the point being, you know, it's not about just the stars.
No.
It's about open to everybody. Come up here
yeah.
and take it. And to me, that because I've seen situations like that where, yeah, we got this deal, and you look and go, well, wait, how come just those three guys are there?
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, I'd like to do that. Well, you know, it's but I mean, to open the door to every player on the road, you know, to me is a pretty amazing thing.
I think to your point, just opening up the doors, yeah. right, to everybody. But not only these guys finding it in themselves, because of the CBA, you can't pay for it, right?
Yeah.
So they're dropping a couple thousand dollars to go up there, plane, ticket, you know, in terms of that, in terms of the hotel, food, and away from family. You got John Denny that has five kids.
Yeah.
I mean, he's got to communicate with his wife. Hey, this is a great opportunity. Yeah. And so when you look at that and the investment they put into it, just from a monetary standpoint, but I told them about the ROI that they'll get from this.
Yeah.
That you never know. I always say one conversation can change your life. You just don't know when it's going to come.
Yeah.
Conversations lead to relationships, and relationships change lives.
Those guys asked me, I just said, look, if he's charging you $50,000 to go up there, pay it and go.
Make it rain.
Pay it and go, man. It'll be worth it.
Make it rain.
At Wee Weedos. Does Kaleb even lift?
Yeah,
my man. See, you're bulking a little bit, huh?
Today, but I lift a little bit.
Your office is right next to the weight room.
I have no excuse. I'm literally 10 feet. If I don't go there, I'm the laziest person. And when you see all these guys that are lifting, I'm like, I have no choice but to go in there.
Get the Juice 14. Is that trade rumor of Jarvis Landry fake? Yes. At Rico 1957. It's for you, Kaleb. What's your background at doing this work? What got you to the position you're at right now?
Well, I think for me, it was at Michigan State University. Mm-hmm. And, you know, my junior year, my father had passed away, unfortunately, which was a terrible time mm-hmm. for me. But it opened up the door to my life and making me realize the preciousness of life, but also watching guys around me on my team mm-hmm. as I became more aware, is watching guys get identity foreclosure into just, I'm a football player, I'm going to the NFL. And it was like, you would have thought 100% of people went to the NFL based on my college teammates. Yeah. And I started to see guys failing once the game was no longer a part of their life, meaning if they didn't make it, mm-hmm. they didn't know what to do. They were scared. They were fearful to go back to the university and ask for help, because if you went back there, it looked at it as you were a failure if you didn't make it to the NFL. And I think things are changing, right?
Yep.
We are developing, and that's where my heart came from. It was seeing these guys fail. And I said, you know what? I got to do something about it. So I started out at Michigan State developing a program there that still occurs in terms of developing them on and off the field to prepare them for when they walk outside those doors for the last time. And then that led to Detroit Lions. To make a long story short, I went down to the combine without a job and interviewed with Jeff Ireland. And they were kind enough to fly me down to Miami after that to do a second interview and met up with Parcells. And the rest is kind of history. But I did borrow my mom's car to get to the combine. I borrowed her credit card to buy a shirt and a tie for the interview because I didn't have one. And it's a tie that I keep in my office every day because it opened up the door for my passion and purpose of serving and just really helping people reach their full potential. So that's kind of how I got here.
Good stuff. Periscope Kale, do you vet prospective agents and accountants that may prey on your players?
Yeah, I love that question.
There's some, I don't care where you go, there's some unscrupulous characters hidden around every corner, it seems like.
When they see blood in the water, okay, they will strike. And I'm not saying everybody that's in that field is bad, okay? Because there's good, bad, average, great, right? So, yes, we do help them vet. We help bring people in that vet the questions to ask. They need to know. They don't even know what questions to ask.
Yeah, sure.
And if a guy has already hired somebody, right, because sometimes they get them before even the draft, why do you have anybody hired yet? Why? You don't even have any money in your account right now. And you don't even know what questions to ask, or you don't even know how they're paid.
Right.
And I ask you the question, how are they paid? And you can't answer that question. We have a conversation. The conversation needs to be happening. So it's kind of like they're all tangled when they get to us, and we have to untangle them.
Well, look, I can remember myself when I was coming out of college. You know, I grew up in a you know, middle class family. My dad held two jobs. My mother worked. You know, my grandmother took care of us.
Right.
Which there's a lot of people, but look, I had a mother and father. I had the whole thing.
Right.
And a lot of guys that I knew growing up, you know, they were single parents, the whole kind of, so everyone comes through a different thing. But you know, I go through college, you know, I'm literally living on $200 a month. Right.
No question.
My father never made more than probably $15,000, and a job and worked twice to maybe, two jobs make $30,000 if that's what he made. I don't even know what he made, but but we weren't, we were skimming by.
Yeah.
So all of a sudden, I'm a first round draft pick. I get a signing bonus, which at the time was a lot of money. Right. Certainly not a lot of money now.
For sure.
And so I asked my dad. I said, Dad, what do you think I should do with this?
Right.
And he looked at me and goes, how do I know? I don't know.
Yeah.
I've never invested any money. I've never had any money to invest. I can't tell you. Mm-hmm. And I go, well, Dad, I got these agents. He goes, well, what do I tell you? I don't have any background to tell you. Mm-hmm. And then so when I got involved, and then even when I got in the league, look, they taught me about a checking account and this and that, but that's all. And I didn't know anything about money. I didn't know about taxes. You didn't know. So, you know, most guys that come in this league are coming from a background where I'm not saying everybody is indigent and they're living in desperation. But most guys have never had any money to speak of.
Yep.
Most people have never thought about saving any money. And most people, most people don't even know how to get a checking account.
Nope.
And all of a sudden, you're sitting there and going, hey, I got $5 million in my hand. I don't even know how to write a check.
You're exactly
right. Around every corner, some guy goes,
I'll show you how to do it.
I'll take
nice
care of you.
Nice suit. Yeah. Looking real good. Talking professional. Yeah. Hey, it looks like the commercials I saw on TV.
Yeah. Yeah.
They look like they know what they're talking about. So to your point, it's very similar, right? A guy is 22, and how do we get them information so they can make decisions like they're 32?
Yeah.
And we have to do that in a short time period. So that's why we spend so much time during the rookie success program when they transition in, which is now going to be called rookie experiences, going over a week-long financial education. Yeah. And then after that, spending one-on-one time with them.
Yeah.
And even that, we fly in their parents. So they can be educated because it starts there as well because your parents didn't have access to that.
Yeah.
They need to be aware too to know what questions to ask because they may use them for a vetting process.
Yeah.
But if they don't know, how are they going to make the decision?
Look, and sometimes the parents become the biggest problem for players because they go, oh, he's making all this money. I want a new house. I want a new car. I want this. I want that. And because they just think the money's inexhaustible. And at some point, you know, that's got to be hard for a player to be able to sit down and say, hey, Mom, Dad, I can't, I feel fortunate that when I got drafted, when I came in the league, we weren't making that much money to where you could,
Yeah, I couldn't. It wasn't on the internet either.
No.
So people could call you and know how much you make, right? Hey, you make this much. Why don't you just give that money to me?
Yeah. So, yeah, good stuff. Let me go run through a couple of these. Ashbicus. At Ashbicus. Describe Jay Ajayi's season in one word. I would say dynamic. That's the word I would put on Jay Ajayi's year. El Chapo Jr., do you think we got a good value by signing Andre Branch? I'm going to tell you what, I've been holding my breath for them to sign Andre Branch. Love Andre Branch. Love what he did. Love what he came in. And I think the team got more out of Andre Branch than they expected from a production standpoint. Not only that, he's a good guy. He's a great teammate. He's a solid guy, and he's going to bust his ass every opportunity he gets. So did we get good value in signing Andre Branch? Absolutely. I have no question about that. Very happy with that.
I agree.
So kind of along the line, Periscope question. How do you deal with family members? We're kind of along the same conversation we were just having.
I think the thing is that you're going to deal with them on a multitude of levels. Yeah. Sometimes it's personally, sometimes it's through the player and educating them, and they have the conversation. But to be honest with you, I educate them as well. Just again, your parents didn't have access to that information, Kim. It's about having access to information and educating them and giving them the tools to be successful as well, and how to best support their son, right? Not as their coach, but as their parent, right? And they have to be educated as well. So I think it's more so it happens to every guy. It's a matter of when family members will come ask you for something. That's probably one of the most common themes that may be in my office is honestly relationships, dynamics, and family, friends. And you have to be careful with that because, hey, if you give mom all this, you know, you're kind of feeling a certain way. And if you don't and you have to cut off a relationship, which guys have had to do before, you're feeling a type of way as well because you lost somebody who you love, you know. Yeah. And so you have a dynamic that most people don't understand, the emotional drain it can get on guys, because you may be emotionally blackmailed and guys have dealt with that before. So I deal with them in a proactive way. I try not to be, again, their go-to for everything, but just try to answer as many questions as I can, as educate as best I can for
and
them.
And be available.
And be available.
If they're looking for you.
Absolutely.
No doubt about it. Asks back, do we look at free agent Elvis Dumervil? Baltimore will let him go. He's out there. I don't know what I don't know how much fuse he has left on the bomb, if you know what I'm saying here. I don't know how much is left in tank on Elvis Dumervil and how much he wants. So, another thing along your lines, is it mandatory that players come to you?
No, I wouldn't say it's mandatory. The rookie transition program, you know, is mandatory.
Yes.
You know, obviously because so many things are changing in their life, and if they're not able to manage all these things around them and really start to lead their life as a pro, first time really on their own, doing a lot of those things that you talked about and writing a check, you know, you don't want it to be mandatory, right? I don't want it to be mandatory for guys. I want them to see what I'm able to do for their life and pour into it, and the care for them to reach their full potential is that they come to me automatically. So if they have something going on, the first person they come to is me, because I'm going to help them solve that problem. Or they're going to be like, hey, these are the questions I have. I just want your opinion before I make this move. You know, so for me, it's a genuine, authentic way where guys, you know, gravitate to my office, even though it's a little cave. You've been in there before, but guys love it. You know, I call it my little cave. Yep. Little box that everybody comes by and stops by.
I would imagine, Kaleb, that the best thing that you could hear from a young player is that, hey, so-and-so told me to come talk to you, that I should come talk to you, that you're a good guy for me to come talk to.
Mm-hmm.
A veteran player that you've worked with. That,
for sure.
That's because the players ultimately are going to believe in other players
for sure
for these types of things.
Mm-hmm.
Coaches, quite frankly, coaches really aren't involved with you at all. They got their own thing to deal with.
Yep.
That's why you're here, to deal with those things for those players, so the coaches don't have to deal with it. But coaches still have to allow you the access to players, and I don't know that every guy that does your job throughout the league gets the access to players. I think that you do, because I think there's organizations, owners, coaches, staff that don't want guys, look, you need to pay attention to this.
Yep.
don't worry about this over here,
right,
because this is what we're paying you to do right here.
Yeah. Every organization, to your point, is run differently.
Yeah.
You know, so when you have an organization that are doing that, some of them are upstairs in my position on the second floor where the guys are on the first, it doesn't give them access. And, you know, it can be tough, but I'm blessed again to be in a position where we understand the value of this position. And, you know, I'm just blessed to be in the position to have the impact that I am. I sit in my car in the parking lot every day. I park the car and just literally go through a gratitude and thankful that I get to pour into somebody's life today. And you never know who's going to need you that day. And you have to be ready at any moment to solve any problem that comes through your door.
Piero Signon. Hey, Bo, did you use your signing bonus to build Bokampers? My signing bonus was long gone before Bokampers came in. But I'll tell you what, I give you. So I was a 19th player picked in 1976. I got a $63,000 signing bonus and $36,000 salary, which was more money than I'd ever imagined I'd have in my life. So what did I do with my signing bonus? I went into a partnership with my agent, and we bought mini warehouse storage, you know, storage facilities.
Yeah.
1976, I invested in the storage facilities.
Wow.
And it was the best investment I ever made. I kick myself right now because I didn't buy more of them at the time. It was the greatest.
Is it still around today?
Well, I've since sold them.
Okay.
I've sold them. Yeah.
Okay.
But, you talk about a guy that got me into the right thing.
Yeah.
And if I wasn't so stubborn, I would have had more of them.
I think it's hard to do in beginning a career now is that so much time is devoted to football. And we always talk about helping guys be pros first, right? Knowing how to manage their time so they can be the best football player. And once you figure that out, especially these rookies in the offseason, first time 3 months off and how many years? I don't know.
Yeah.
You know, so now you have time and the money and you have to make a big decision on how you allocate your time. So I think for you back then, hey, it might have been good. But nowadays, I'm encouraging these guys, be a pro, right? We're setting their schedule up to be a pro. And once you learn how to do that, guess what? The business combine is available to you now because you knew how to be a pro, manage your time. You're never late. You do the right things. You study your playbook. And I know you're going to go up there and do the right thing there.
The good thing for me is I feel very fortunate that I found the right guy.
Yeah, for sure.
That he was a legitimate guy, that we got into a legitimate business. It wasn't some fly-by-night thing.
For sure.
And I learned that. And that was my education. That was the beginning of my education into business. Now, did my signing bonus help build Bokampers? No, but certainly the experience of what I did with my signing bonus was the beginning of my track to get to where I'm at right now in the business world.
And it's been awesome to watch you expand. When I came down here in 2010, on March 3rd, 2010, was when I flew down here. It was a 4 days notice in Detroit. You're hired.
Yeah.
I gave away all my winter clothes to my friends up in Michigan.
Yeah.
I said goodbye to my family, and I was down here. And I remember the first place I went to, because I stayed at the hotel down the street, the Renaissance. And guess what? I ate at Bokampers. Yeah. That was my first dining experience. And now we still love to go. And once I found out, I had no history.
Yeah.
So once I found out it was Kim Bokamper, you know, he played with the Dolphins, I'm like, how do I continue to support our guys? And I love eating there.
Yeah.
Heck, when we got married, we held our rehearsal dinner at your spot. So it's good to just pour back into guys. And I think that's what you're talking about, Kim, is that access that you had at an early age afforded you the opportunity to be and have business acumen and gain it over time, that now you're blowing up.
The flip side for me is that I had a guy that came in, he was our second round draft pick or third round draft pick the year. We used to call him Big Paper because he would get his check and he would just cash it. He never had a bank account, put in his pocket, always had a wad of cash. We called him Big Paper all the time. And so he calls me during the offseason, after our rookie year.
Yeah.
And we're still friends now. He called me midway through. He called me in April. He said, hey, someone called me, I got to pay taxes. He said, I don't have any money left. He spent all his money because he didn't, you know.
Yeah.
But that's the, you know, but that's the, and I'm sure that's nothing new to you.
No, those
types of things. So, and it's not that he wasn't a smart guy. He just, same thing. Came from a background where he didn't have anybody to lean on.
You could come from an average background.
Yeah.
Like literally, it could come from middle class. You may have had access to financial advisors growing up, right? But when you're signing cards, right, and they give you this big check of $70,000, $170,000, you're like, man, this is awesome. But guess what? you didn't pay taxes on that, and you didn't realize you had to pay income tax season. And now I'm a rookie, and I owe $80,000 to the government.
Because,
and
I'm like, he goes, I don't know, I can pay, I can owe taxes. They took tax out of my check.
Oh, what about that card signing? Oh, what about this? You know, so even even young guys, they you know, I don't expect them to know that, and that's why exposure is the key. Exposure is the key.
No, look, you the work you're doing is important. These guys should feel very happy that they have the opportunity, that that this organization commits so much time and effort to the jobs that you and Eves do, and you deserve a lot of credit, and I give a lot of credit to the guys that come in and reach out to you and do the stuff that they do, because it is very, very helpful. And guys, I know there are guys down the road that probably didn't take advantage or didn't go through it. They're thinking, man, I wish I would have spent more time in that office and picked up some things. But look, people learn in different ways, and they live their lives differently. So
absolutely. Live and learn, right?
Live and learn. Caleb, always a pleasure, my man.
Thank you, Kim.
Good job up there with the guys in New York. I know they had a great trip up there, a lot of good stuff. We'll be back on Friday. I think we're going to be a little early on Friday, right, Leon? Got some big news. It's going to be an interesting show on Friday, so just keep an eye out for it, and check us out when we come on. We'll be, as I said, we'll be here Friday. Have a good day tomorrow. Stay safe, and we'll see you Friday afternoon.